welcome to the Generation Y Conservative Show. I am your host, Chris Ford, and I'm glad that you could join me tonight. I am a new host to the network on Mojo 5.0, and we got a lot of things going on. Some of you may not know me already from my show, but we certainly have a lot of episodes in the past, and I'm just coming on. I'm going to explain a little bit more about that, as well as some other connections to the Mojo network that I have myself. But in the meantime, we're going to be talking about a lot of different things tonight, including my story, how I came to be on the Mojo network here for my first episode. We're also going to talk about my connection to Doc Thompson. We have some entertainment things that we're going to be going over, including a book review that I just got done with here. We're going to go into politics, talking about Beto O'Rourke and Elizabeth Warren, and also something happening outside of the Democrats' office in D.C., going with the flags, which is an interesting situation. Also, we're going to see a gun spotlight review with a coordination that I have with a local firearm dealership, which is really awesome. And we're going to hear my conservative reflection make a return to the show. We're going to hear about all that and more. This is the Generation Y Conservative Show. Everyone for joining me tonight. If you haven't been with me before, you can always follow along on social media. The most important one is actually head over to the YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/GenYConservative, and subscribe and hit the bell, because those of us in conservative media certainly are not getting the best treatment from YouTube, and it's hard to get more subscribers once you hit a certain point. And we're getting demonetized. I've been demonetized already. I get copyright infringements all the time, but they never strike me for anything, and the community strikes. But I really would appreciate if you could actually head over there and hit subscribe and the bell. Also, if you're interested, you could always follow along with the stories that I'm interested in by finding the Generation Y Conservative fan page on Facebook. Hit like and get notifications on there, and then you can also interact with me on Twitter at Gen Y Conservative without the E on the end. I would really appreciate that. You can actually find all past episodes of the show on platforms like Spreaker, iTunes, iHeartRadio, and KLRN Internet Radio carried me as well. So you can search anywhere that you subscribe to podcasts. If you're interested in listening to past episodes, I would actually encourage you to go over there and listen to a few. We actually go over quite a few things, but this new show is actually a condensed version of what we used to do, which was a three-hour show with no commercial breaks and no sponsors or anything. So it was just a straight 3 hours of talking. So I'll save you all that trouble here as we go into the Mojo family. Before we get started there, we're going to go over Patriot Mobile. Now, if you're not familiar with cell phone companies out there, there's obviously the big ones, but if you actually look into where they spend your money, it's going to all the wrong places usually. And it's kind of frustrating when you hear anywhere from your taxes going to things that you don't want, things like abortion and everything else. But then when you actually have to go and find out that the cell phone plan that you pay for is actually using that money to support things like abortion as well, you can actually look into some of the big cell phone carriers and find that they're actually doing that. And it's really frustrating to see your money going to things that you don't support. And that's where Patriot Mobile comes in. Patriot Mobile, I've been actually following along with them ever since Doc Thompson mentioned them on the network, and it's a pretty cool company. They actually take your money and put it towards organizations that you would actually support, things that support conservative causes are things that we should always be investing our time and money into. Patriot Mobile has some great deals going on. They support all of your rights as a freedom-loving American. That's all there is to say about that. With plans starting as low as $25 a month, who can beat that, right? So all you have to do is call 1-800-A-PATRIOT and use the code MOJO50, or visit the patriotmobile.com/MOJO50 to waive your activation fee there. And listen, once you get Patriot Mobile, you could always just go ahead and get a American flag case for whatever phone you bring over to that or one of their phones. Download a God Bless the USA ringtone. Maybe put a little bit of liberal whining, liberals crying or screaming at the sky when Trump won the election for every time you get a text notification. Have a little fun with it. I have a Abraham Lincoln statue from the Lincoln Memorial as my wallpaper. So when a liberal client of mine sees me opening up my phone, they may know what's going on. But listen, again, go to patriotmobile.com/mojo50 to learn more about their cell phone plans or call 1-800-A-PATRIOT and use the code MOJO50. It's time to switch cell phone plans and actually go to people that support what you support. All right, so listen. Let's talk about how I actually came over to the Mojo 50 family and my connections here. Number one, I actually reached out a couple weeks ago right prior to CPAC, and many of you may actually know me from an interview that I did on the Defenders Live show. Those guys over there happened to see a tweet that I sent out to a couple radio personalities out there in regards to the big conversation that's going on in public right now over abortion. And it's saddening to me to see that a lot of these supposedly pro-life radio hosts that linger in the conservative media are all about being pro-life until a certain point, and they can't understand why someone would actually save a life of a child if it's the product of a rape or incest. And granted, listen, I think that's a tough thing, but I want to share my personal story that the guys at Defenders Live and the conservative cartel, for that matter, interviewed me on the same subject at CPAC this year and give you a little insight into what actually happened to me. I want to jump back a little bit here and try to make this as quick as possible. But what happened was when I was back in high school, I think a lot of us realize, and it's probably even worse now because I graduated in 2001, that the health classes that you take actually push abortion as a type of birth control. Right? And it's no big deal. It's something that happens all the time. And they're really grooming young women and sometimes men as well to encourage the girls to go and get these abortions like it's no big deal. And so back in high school, I would have considered myself a pretty liberal student because of what I see now clearly as the indoctrination of what happens in public education. So from there, I went on to college and I actually met a young woman who I was seeing for quite a little while, and she broke down to me the one time and started talking about how she had an abortion when she was in high school. She was crying. She was wondering what kind of mother she would be at this point. Would it be a boy? Would it be a girl? What would they be doing? What would they be like? And for the first time in my life, I actually saw this side of the abortion story that they never talk about in public education, and that is the mental anguish that a lot of young girls and women go through after a physical procedure of having an abortion and taking the life of an individual and knowing that they took a life. I mean, that's where the mental anguish comes in. Where would they be? What kind of person would they be? So at that point, I really relinquished myself to being pro-life, except for the case of rape and incest, because I saw once I started looking into things that not only were these women having mental anguish, but it also led to a lot of physical problems and problems with giving birth later on in life, that these are complications that can arise from abortion. Well, I started talking about that a little bit more with friends and family and started coming out as pro-life and talking about how I can understand all of it except for the case of rape and abortion. I couldn't imagine having a woman go through with that and actually delivering a product of rape. It was only a couple months of actually going around talking about this with friends and family when I actually found out from my own mother that my grandfather, her father, was the product of rape himself. Back in the early 1900s, his mother's parents, when she was in her later teens, died unexpectedly. And in order to survive at 18 or 19 years old, she had to go and work on a farm in order to pay for her own living. It was at that point that the farm owner, who was married at the time, actually raped my great-grandmother, and she ran off, stayed with a friend, and decided between the two of them that not only would she have this baby, but she would actually give my grandfather over to her friend to raise, as that was her choice under the circumstances, which were pretty pressure-filled, obviously. You know, I can understand that. So he grew up actually referring to his real mother as his aunt, and his mother was her friend. And it was a pretty interesting situation. But what you have to understand is, when you actually backtrack our family tree, if it weren't for that decision of my great-grandmother to actually go forward and move forward and have this baby, there would be 28 less family members alive today under our family tree had she chosen to have an abortion. So when people come to me and they say, well, you can't expect a woman to have an abortion, that's like having a demon seed. It's only going to come out like the father. It's going to be, inherit those violent genes and those tendencies of that person, and you're just putting another person into the world. Well, I would greatly disagree with that. Not only do I not know of anyone in my family who has ever committed a violent crime or rape or anything like that, I would also mention that there are close people in my family that have been raped, and I've seen the horror of that. It's a terrible thing, and it's hard for people to hear on the religious side, which I am a Christian. You will hear Christian topics on this show. It's hard to hear that God may have a plan for that child. And that child, sometimes you can hear from people, will actually bring healing to the mother over the situation. And that's a tough thing to do. It's a tough thing to call for. It's a tough thing for you to look into the eyes of someone that has survived a rape and say, you know, maybe you should have this baby. Maybe this is part of God's plan. And I understand the difficulty of that and trying to weigh those circumstances and everything. But that's what it came down to in our family. So I am strictly pro-life right now. And it was pretty interesting to actually go on to these multiple radio programs while I was on a CPAC and doing different interviews, talking to the guys at Defenders Live about where we are as a country right now with all these abortion policies going out and what these politicians are pushing for. You know, it used to be back in my early childhood that abortions would be safe, rare, and legal, right? And that's not the case anymore. At that point in time, you were talking about, well, once you find out you're pregnant, that you can get an abortion and that you can't really tell what's going on in there anyway. As a matter of fact, when I talk about public education, I remember specifically in one of my either health or biology classes in high school, they actually put pictures of different babies or fetuses up on the board in the womb of different animals and a human fetus. And she said, if you can't understand the difference between them right now, then it's just a fetus. And a lot of them did look very similar, and you really did have to look. But no students are able to react in that situation and look at the teacher and come out and say, hey, listen, yes, maybe these all look the same at this stage in their life right now, but you're not going to have a giraffe or a dog come out of your this woman when she gives birth. It doesn't make any sense. And yeah, certainly students can speak up about that, but the problem in public education is we're taught to respect our elders and to listen to the teachers and to take tests the way that they want you to take those tests. And so it makes it really difficult to put that pressure on a student to actually then go and challenge a teacher without these circumstances arising or consequences where the student itself himself or herself may get in trouble for even attempting to question what the teacher is saying. And you can get into a lot of trouble for that. I've personally gotten into trouble in college classroom settings for questioning socialism, as a matter of fact. So we'll be talking about all those things and more, including I plan over the next couple of weeks to tell you why I consider myself a conservative, libertarian, pro-life person. This is just one of the stories that led me to being pro-life. But when you see what's going on in society today with these policies, we were talking about how it was safe, rare, and legal. That was typically in the earlier stages. And then we started getting ultrasound technology up to par for what it is today, and people could see what was going on. And then we had people arguing for late-term abortions. We just had in the New York State with Cuomo arguing that you should be able to have an abortion up until the point where the baby is starting to come out of the uterus, which is totally disgusting to me. And then you had Governor Northam down in Virginia actually advocating for a baby that is born alive, sitting on a table, that you would make that baby comfortable in the meantime and have a discussion with the family on what to do with it. Meaning, are we going to kill it or do you want to keep it? And if they want to kill it, that's exactly what they would do. This harkens back to during the Obama administration, hospitals in Chicago leaving babies in the linen closets to die that the mothers didn't want. I mean, this is disgusting stuff. We are talking about outside of the womb, this whole argument of this is a woman's body, it's her choice, becomes null and void once that baby is delivered and is no longer part of the body. That argument goes out the window. You've just lost on that argument because you are no longer talking about a baby that's inside the womb supposedly being a parasite, even though the definition of a parasite means basically living off the life and sucking the life and degrading the life of its host in order to survive. That's not the case of what goes on with the baby. But it's just absolutely disgusting what we're actually seeing in today's society. And I would encourage you in the meantime to actually look up a video on YouTube of a woman in England talking about killing her children that are years after being born, suffering by smothering them with a pillow. Is that our next step? I don't know. So, listen, before we go on, we're going to go talk about Riduzone. You know, I'm one of these people. America has a weight problem, right? I may look it to some of you. I may not look it like it to some of you, but I have a weight problem, and I'm trying to work on that myself. But America itself is one of the heaviest nations on earth. And why is that? Hey, listen, number one, I would tell you that that shows that we are doing pretty well. You know, we're not starving. We're not skin and bones in this nation and everything. We have a lot to live for. We live in abundance in America. But sometimes living in abundance comes with paying a price. And sometimes that price is actually your health. So this is actually considered America's first weight management supplement of the OEA. And OEA is a natural metabolite of olive oil produced in the human body. So that's kind of cool. Riduzone is a formulation of OEA to aid healthy weight loss. It is safe and FDA accepted. Says that the body needs 12 liters of olive oil to produce as much as an OEA in one bottle of Riduzone. So that's pretty cool. It supports healthy weight, low calorie consumption, efficient metabolism of body fat. And it's also a safe product to use, as we said, with the FDA actually giving their okay with it. It's a non-stimulant, naturally present in the body, vegetarian, gluten-free, and non-GMO for all of you out there who believe that. I personally have a feeling that some of that goes a little overboard. That's all I'm saying. It's patented, FDA-accepted supplement. Start your weight loss journey now. Check it out at riduzone.com. That's R-I-D-U-Z-O-N-E.com. And when you order, you can you will receive a special 30% off coupon automatically applied to your three-bottle, three-month supply. All you have to do is go to riduzone.com. That's R-I-D-U-Z-O-N-E. So I don't know if anybody wants to send that to me as a gift. I could probably use it. That would be fun. All right, so let's see here. We have gone over my discussion with Defenders Live and also with Conservative Cartel while I was on Media Row at CPAC. That was really cool. Both of them, we were basically talking about this connection I have to my pro-life story and how I became pro-life, how I went through that progression from being pro-choice, kind of liberal in high school, to absolutely, without a doubt, being pro-life. Well, one of the things I went over with both the Defenders Live guys and the Conservative Cartel is also a special connection that I have with Mojo 5.0. And I kind of wanted to go over that as well before we end the first segment here. And that is that, I guess we'll say the radio network that shall remain unnamed is where Doc Thompson used to work before Mojo 5.0, or kind of during it, actually. He was starting Mojo 5.0. And him and his co-host actually really tried to help me out after I made a video go viral to try and get hired by that company by going viral enough that they would want to contact me for a position that they didn't even have at the time. So I was kind of trying to blaze a trail there, leveraging social media to my advantage and get them to notice me. And it was a long shot. No one had faith in me, not even my wife. She kind of faked it for a while. And then once I actually got a call from the president of the company, the president of the parent company of it and everything, we were seriously thinking about packing up and moving down to Texas. It was pretty interesting. But Doc Thompson and his co-host Skip Lacombe were the first ones to really dive in and say, hey, Chris, we will get you in front of the appropriate people. We'll see you at CPAC. We'll try to get you in front of people there. We're going to send all your stuff over to the appropriate people at this media company. And there were others that got involved in the company as well, but Doc Thompson and Skip Lacombe were really the first ones to really push me out there in front of them and really try to help me out. I did meet them at CPAC a couple years ago. I believe that was 3 or 4 years ago. And it was really interesting. When I got the chance to meet up with them, that was the only video that I had produced at the time, was this marketing concept based on my marketing background on how to reach out to youth a little bit better by leveraging social media and short attention spans for people. The one thing that Doc Thompson and Skip both said to me as a piece of advice was, listen, what you did was great, but it's going to get stale the more you try to reach out and try to get in front of people and get their attention. What you need to do is continue to make video content. Well, I've left everything that I've made up on YouTube. Some of it kind of embarrassing at this point. You can actually go back all the way through my YouTube channel. That's just search for the Generation Y Conservative on YouTube. And you'll actually see that some of the earlier versions of my podcast was just me taking topic by topic and hitting it with the different things and going into it. You'll see things I said about Trump that I, you know, did an analysis on him that I wasn't too proud of, and it is what it is. I completely changed my mind on him. I was a big Ted Cruz supporter, but then I decided to do a podcast and turn it into long form entertainment, and it turned into a 3-hour show. It was picked up by another internet radio station for the past 2 years, and it's been taking off. But I really believe in my heart of hearts that being here on Mojo is the next step for me and for conservative media as a whole. I believe that they're blazing trails with what they're doing right now, and seeing all the shows that they have lined up during the week and on the weekends, I mean, it's great entertainment. And I think that this is the next opportunity for conservatives, and I hope that, you know, like the Conservative Cartel and especially the guys at Defenders Live who have been messaging with me privately to help me get going, we have to, as conservatives, reach out to each other as media or content providers and start making these connections and working together, because the left is trying to shut us down right now, and big companies like YouTube, Facebook, Google, they're all after us. Twitter, they're all after us to shut us down, and we have to start working together. But listen, We'll get to more. We're going to actually go over some entertainment topics in the next segment. Stay tuned for the next half hour after these commercial messages.